always, when those people try out, try the Italians, American, well, I said, let them, you see, let them find out, I mean, by on their own, you see, because if I tell them so, they won't believe me.
You they mentioned something about trying to breed on mutations.
Yes, well, the American scientists, it's mentioned in this book, you see, they have concentrated on mutations, you see. Because the practical breeding work, you see, they just haven't got the necessary facilities. Whereas they can play with mutations. I've been 3 times in the United States, you see. And actually I have an invitation for next year, but I'm not going, you see. And so I know fairly well what's going on there, you see. And they think that they can, by studying those mutations, they can discover how the different characteristics are propagated, you see. But to my mind, this work is all, as I say, because I mention it in this book, there's a chart that I've discovered so far. I've named them, I've given them symbols, 30 mutations, you say. But the majority of them are in connection with the eye color. And there are some with in the connection with the wing formation, you say. But most of them are in connection, well, now drones, you see, that are affected that way. They cannot see. Mm-hmm. You see, their sight is impaired.
Yes.
And their queens affected that way. Actually, I don't know whether they are queens that are affected. It's mainly, you see, in the case of the honeybee, you get the mutations mainly in the drones. Because, you see, there's only one series of genetic disposition. And if one of them fails, well, there's nothing really to replace it.
No.
You see. Whereas in the bees themselves, you get some of the mutations in bees too. In bees too. But then there are two genetic dispositions at issue. And if one factor fails, you see, the other one, the reciprocal one, may dominate, mm-hmm. and you may not notice it. You may only, it will only come to the surface when you inbreed.
Yes.
Then they'll come. To the,
So the Americans that try to breed from mutations, they do it just for scientific purposes?
Yeah, but this is more purely from the scientific.
Yes.
They don't expect to be able to develop a super bee or a bee that's better than any. It's merely to study the transmission of genetic factors. But to my mind, they won't achieve very much that way, you see. But the actual breeding as carried out by us, you see, that's a much more serious work. That's a much more serious work. And in America, they would have the facilities. But I think the feeling that scientists don't want to be tied down to a practical work of this kind.
No.
Yeah.
I see what you mean.
Yeah.
It's too much sweat.
Yes, it's too much. Mm-hmm. You see, as one practical American beekeeper, Mr. Maraz, whom I know very well, I stayed at his home and he has 2,000 colonies and he has very wide experience. He wrote once in cleanings, you see, he says, I often have sleepless nights because I'm not sure whether I made the right decision. You see, and the upkeep of my family depends on the income.
Yes.
He says, whereas scientists, you see, they have no such scruples. Whether they're whether their findings or their conclusions are correct makes no difference to their monthly salary.
No.
That which is quite correct. That's a practical beekeeper, you see. You see, and I said in an article in a German magazine, also the Professor Rutner claimed that the science shows the way to further progress, you see, is the leader, and the people follow them. Mm-hmm. I said that maybe in the case of engineering, you see, if an engineer makes a mistake in the design of a plane, well, the plane will come down, and all the thing will be investigated, and finally they'll find the fault. Then, of course, the scientists will get the blame. It's also just in medicine. You see, well, if a doctor publishes findings, you say, and then, of course, well, it will be attested all over the world. Mm-hmm. You see, suppose it's an important finding. And if he's not found correct, he'll be at once disputed.
Yes.
You see, and his reputation is at fault. But in beekeeping, scientists can say what they like. There's nobody to stand up.
No, except you.
It's, well, yes, but then, of course, you see, then they're up in arms. You see, in connection when Rutner said that scientists lead, you see, and the beekeepers follow. Well, I said, this may be true in engineering and medicine, but not in beekeeping. That science is more like a drug shoe. You know what a drug shoe is?
Yes.
It's a formula when they, mm-hmm. in the farm carts, when they went down a hill, they put an iron shoe on the one wheel. See, so that the wheel didn't revolve. The weight of the vehicle pushed the cart forward. But the drug shoe kept so that it didn't go too fast. And so I said it's the same. Mm-hmm. They cannot stop progress, but they merely hinder it. And of course they got furious over that. It's true. I'm not afraid to tell the truth to anybody. Because it makes it material, I mean, what they think, you see. But I think it's a shame for instance, also, there's the editor of the Eckerman, I know him very well, of the Nordwestdeutsche Imkerzeitung. He said once that scientists, you know, they go to America, they go to Russia, and they see this, and they see that, but they come back and they say, this is all right in Russia. This is all right in America, but doesn't work here. And he said, well, that way, beekeepers have lost millions, if not milliards, in value, in money, due to that, because they are believed. You see. And it is quite right. He merely put it in other words what I said about the drug shoe. You see, and in Germany there is this attitude. When a scientist says something, it must be true. The old people, now the young generation, don't believe people, the scientists anymore. Mm. No, they don't trust them anymore, you see. No. The young generation, you see. But the old people, of course, they take everything as gospel truth. Mm. Yeah. Oh, yes. And of course, the same thing is true in all the German-speaking countries, you see. I don't think it's quite to the same extent in France, you see, because in France there is more a keeping of bees, because those bees are so extremely aggressive. You cannot handle them, and you cannot introduce queens, you see, and all that. So there it's a keeping of bees. I was with a commercial beekeeper in the Jura in 1950 for a whole week, and this firm had 2,000 colonies. That was in May, You see, every day they send out the men, you go to this area, you go to that area and look whether there are any swarms. If there are swarms on the tree, you shake them into an empty box and go to the next. Where the swarm came from, they are not interested, you see. And actually they showed me their records and they said, now look here, this colony has existed for 3 years. You see, the other one has only for 2 years. Because what they do, each spring, they take a number of colonies to the south of France, they wipe them up, let them rear queens, and then let them build up to colonies. And those are the colonies which replace the winter losses, you see, or the summer losses, colonies that go down due to swarm. There's no beekeeping, as it may be here and there, but the general, for instance, you heard of a Zimmer, well, he works with our bees, and he works with our type of hive, and he gets record crops. You see, he gets record crops. Because France is an exceedingly, the flora for beekeeping is exceedingly favorable to beekeeping.
The Buckfast bee has, what do you say, not emerged, what's the word for it?
It's now being introduced.
Yes.
Zimmer, you see, lives in Alsace near Colmar.
Yes, in France and in Scandinavia.
Yes, well, Scandinavia. Yes.
And in Israel and the United States and New Zealand.
Yes. Well, I mean, all over the German countries, you see. I can tell you there was some queens, about 100 queens in the Burma, you say. But of course what happens to them, unless the Buckfast bee is rightly managed, you see, it won't give the result. You see, what is the trouble in Germany? Most of the beekeepers try to manage the Buckfast bee the same as they do the Guernica. They pull the hive to pieces and do all sorts of stupid things. You see, whereas here with the Buckfast bee, you want to develop on its own, you see. And you don't want too much interference.
We have noticed that in Sweden, lots of beekeepers are used to the native bee.
Yes.
And then they try to handle the Buckfast bee the same way.
Yes, and of course that is...
And it doesn't function.
No, it doesn't answer. It doesn't end.
What is the proper way to handle the Buckfast bee?
Well, if you read the book, Beekeeping a Buckfast Abbey, there you have got it in... you have got it in black and white.
Yes, but you recommend people to buy your book, I understand that.
But of course what I find, you see, it's often, for instance, even people are prepared to adopt a larger hive. I think I want to make it quite clear, modified date and hive, the type of hive we use is not essential. We got honey, you see, before we changed over to the MD. But only with the MD, you get more honey with less work.
Yes.
You see, with less work. But at the same time, you see, I find many people are prepared to change over to the MD hive. But they still think in Guernica terms. You see, which is wrong. Which is wrong.
Det här är lite, den sista meningen i hans bok, han skriver att idealistiskt arbete och sådär. Kan du ta upp till någonting? Det är det han kommit in på lite grann. Hur han liksom har byggt upp det här med att funka med att vara hemma. Om man jobbar mycket enkelt så mycket och idealistiskt så får man också en ekonomisk lönsamhet. Tror du kan komma in på det? Det är
bandet
slut. Vad sa du?
Yes, there is a very attractive point in your writing.
Yes.
That often people think there is a contradiction between beekeeping as a romantic thing and idealistic work and the economy in it. But you have made it come together in a beautiful way.
Yes, I think, like I say, at the end of the book, I have always spoken about commercial importance and the economic importance. Yes, but that doesn't mean that we don't value the aesthetic. You see, we value the aesthetic as much as the economic aspect. But on the other hand, of course, we must make beekeeping pay.
Yes, and there is... The aesthetics depend on the commercial if one looks at a long sight.
Yes.
I mean the
economic considerations don't annul the aesthetic considerations,
no.
You see. The two should work in harmony. And that's what I've been always striving at. In fact, in everything what I do, let's say, for instance, only a few days ago we were considering here the new edition of the book describing the results of my journeys. That's the English edition, you see. And the English edition, the fringe of the pages was very narrow. Well, I would like them wider, you see, because they give the book a more dignified appearance, you see. Now, there was another beekeeper here who said, well, no, I mean, they buy the book because you have written it. And I said,